Senhoras e senhores, boa tarde. É com muita satisfação que hoje realizamos a abertura do 10º Seminário Internacional Universidade, Inovação, Ciência e Transcendência, promovido pela Pró-Reitoria de Pesquisa, Inovação e Desenvolvimento da Pontifícia Universidade Católica do Rio Grande do Sul. Nesta 10ª edição, o seminário tem em seu tema central tópicos como fé, espiritualidade e transcendência, que se apresentam tão carentes de formas inovadoras de exploração e interpretação. Chegou, portanto, o momento de a PUC-RS liderar um movimento de intensa troca de ideias e experiências entre disciplinas, especialistas e pensadores em torno deste tema tão relevante. Este seminário sobre ciência e transcendência é, portanto, muito bem-vindo. Damos início à cerimônia destacando a presença do professor, doutor e irmão Joaquim Cloté, magnífico reitor da Pontifícia Universidade Católica do Rio Grande do Sul, da professora doutora Carla Bonan, diretora de pesquisa, neste ato representando o professor doutor Jorge Aldi, pró-reitor de pesquisa, inovação e desenvolvimento, e da professora doutora Marília Costa Morosini, coordenadora do Centro de Estudos em Educação Superior da Faculdade de Educação da PUC-RS e coordenadora deste seminário. Agradecemos, igualmente, a presença do excelentíssimo senhor vice-reitor, professor, doutor e irmão Evilásio Teixeira, e em seu nome saudamos também os integrantes da comissão organizadora deste seminário, dos senhores pró-reitores, dos senhores assessores da reitoria, diretores, coordenadores de departamentos e comunidade acadêmica da PUC-RS, dos representantes das demais instituições de ensino aqui presentes, demais convidados, e ainda a colaboração dos palestrantes que aceitaram o convite para participar deste evento, os nossos convidados externos, o doutor Kenneth Miller, da Universidade de Brown, nos Estados Unidos, o professor doutor irmão Clemente Juliato, ex-reitor da PUC Paraná, e a doutora Cláudia Costin, diretora de educação do Banco Mundial, que estará conosco amanhã. E os convidados da nossa casa, o doutor Jaderson Costa da Costa, diretor do Instituto do Cérebro do Rio Grande do Sul, o padre Érico Rames, da Faculdade de Teologia da PUC-RS, o doutor André Luiz Palmini, chefe do Serviço de Neurologia do Hospital São Lucas, e os professores Nitamar de Oliveira e Ernildo Stein, da Faculdade de Filosofia e Ciências Humanas da PUC-RS. Convidamos a todos agora para cantarmos o hino nacional. Passamos a palavra à professora doutora Marília Costa Morosini, coordenadora do Centro de Estudos em Educação Superior da Faculdade de Educação da PUC-RS e coordenadora deste seminário, para dar início à abertura oficial do evento.
Boa tarde a todos. É com muito prazer que agradecemos e gostaríamos de registrar nosso agradecimento e cumprimentar ao nosso magnífico reitor, a professora doutora Carla Bonan, que representa nessa ocasião o professor Jorge Aldi, pró-reitor de pesquisa, aos assessores da reitoria, diretores, coordenadores, a nossa comunidade acadêmica, aos representantes de demais instituições que aqui se fazem presente, aos irmãos maristas, aos demais convidados, em especial aos palestrantes que aceitaram o convite e vieram de tão longe para este evento. Neste momento, gostaria de relembrar que a instituição universidade, ela vem se mantendo desde a Idade Média como formadora de recursos humanos de alto nível e que ela atravessa, no Brasil principalmente, um grande processo de flexibilização e de diversificação, voltando-se à internacionalização, entre outros aspectos. Estas questões vêm sendo discutidas nesse seminário, cujo grande mote é Universidade e Inovação. Já trabalhamos com empreendedorismo, interdisciplinaridade, qualidade, relação com a sociedade, internacionalização, integridade na pesquisa, prestação de serviços, financiamento, relação com as pessoas e, neste momento, no décimo seminário, estamos trabalhando com ciência e transcendência. Gostaria de registrar um especial agradecimento à equipe que vem trabalhando há um ano praticamente para que esse seminário possa levantar questões importantes a serem discutidas. A equipe se constituiu do professor Jorge Aldi e do irmão Evilásio, nosso vice-reitor na presidência do evento, representando a pastoral Maurício Peronde, pelo INSER, o professor Jaderson Costa da Costa, o professor André Luiz Fernandes Palmini, o padre Érico, a professora Lúcia Girafa, a Edna Santos, da gabinete da reitoria, que muito tem nos assessorado, a Mariana Beth, ao Marcos Poli e a Raquel. Nesse momento também eu gostaria de registrar um especial agradecimento ao nosso reitor, que em suas visitas científicas internacionais a destacadas universidades, tem selecionado figuras de excelência para a programação nas discussões do seminário. São essas as minhas palavras e obrigado.
Obrigado.
Neste momento, convidamos a fazer uso da palavra a professora doutora Carla Bonan, diretora de pesquisa, neste ato representando o professor doutor Jorge Aldi, pró-reitor de pesquisa, inovação e desenvolvimento.
Magnífico reitor, professor doutor irmão Joaquim Clotê, nosso vice-reitor, irmão Evilásio Teixeira, professora Marília Morosini, coordenadora deste evento, senhores pró-reitores, assessores, diretores, professores, boa tarde a todos. Em primeiro lugar, eu gostaria de expressar, em nome da Pró-Reitoria de Pesquisa, Inovação e Desenvolvimento, ao representar o nosso pró-reitor, professor Jorge Luiz Nicolas Aldi, a satisfação por chegarmos neste momento em que damos início ao 10º Seminário Internacional Universidade, Inovação, Ciência e Transcendência. Ao longo desses 10 anos, o Seminário Internacional representa um espaço de reflexão e discussão sobre temas importantes e os principais desafios que se apresentam para a educação superior e para o desenvolvimento científico e tecnológico. Em 2006, a primeira edição deste seminário discutiu a questão da inovação e do empreendedorismo, sendo que nas suas edições seguintes, outras temáticas importantes foram abordadas, como a internacionalização, a interdisciplinaridade, a integridade na pesquisa, a qualidade, a relação com a sociedade, e na edição de 2014 foi abordado o tema relacionado com as pessoas. Nesse sentido, considerando a missão da nossa universidade fundamentada na tradição educativa marista, Torna-se bastante significativo abordarmos nesta 10ª edição a dimensão da ciência e transcendência. Essa discussão nos possibilitará uma reflexão sobre o significado da transcendência e da espiritualidade na universidade, seus reflexos na ciência e na educação superior, bem como as questões éticas relacionadas a esse tema. Gostaria de agradecer aos palestrantes desse seminário que aceitaram compartilhar suas ideias e experiências conosco neste evento, a professora Marília Morosini, coordenadora do evento, e toda a equipe organizadora responsável pela realização deste seminário. Desejo um excelente evento a todos. Muito obrigada.
Convidamos para seu pronunciamento o professor, doutor e irmão Joaquim Cloté, magnífico reitor da Pontifícia Universidade Católica do Rio Grande do Sul.
Uma boa tarde, senhor vice-reitor Imar Velásquez Teixeira, senhores pró-reitores, professora Carla Monan, diretora de pesquisa, professora Marília Morosini, coordenadora do Centro de Estudos e Educação Superior da Faculdade de Educação da PUC e coordenadora deste seminário. Diretores de unidades universitárias, integrantes da comissão organizadora, nossos palestrantes convidados, professor irmão Clemente Juliat, ex-reitor da PUC do Paraná, professor Kenneth Miller, da Brown University, a doutora Cláudia Costin, do Banco Mundial, estará aqui amanhã, demais professores de nossa universidade, professor Jaderson Costa da Costa, doutor André Palmini, padre Érico James, professor Ernildo Stein, professor Nitamar Oliveira, professores, alunos e demais convidados. Sejam bem-vindos à 10ª edição do Seminário Internacional, reconhecido pela excelência e pela atualidade dos temas nele tratados, assim como pelos diferenciados palestrantes vindos do exterior e do nosso país. Inovação, ciência e transcendência constituem uma tríade polêmica e instigante, que tem como locus apropriado a universidade, que é âmbito do saber, do questionamento e do diálogo, pois discutir, refutar e debater são passos fundamentais para a construção do conhecimento. A história da filosofia, da teologia e da ciência apresenta exemplos que testemunham esse indispensável percurso da busca da verdade. Evidenciado nas questões disputadas medievais, assim como nos diálogos contemporâneos, por exemplo, só vou citar alguns, de Frederick Copleston e Bertrand Russell. Frederick Copleston, eu conheci ele no Heathrow College da Universidade de Londres, católico, também professor de teologia, ele tem uma história da filosofia de 8 volumes, extraordinária, e Copleston dialogou com Bertrand Russell, Lord Russell, filósofo, prêmio Nobel e, além disso, grande professor de lógica e lógica matemática. Um exemplo, Copleston e Bertrand Russell, posicionamentos totalmente diferentes, mas dialogando na mesma mesa e através da BBC. Um outro exemplo, Joseph Ratzinger, o nosso Papa emérito, que soube dialogar com Jürgen Habermas sobre temas também relacionados com a fé e a razão. Há pouco, cardeal Walter Brandmüller e Ingo Langer, dois posicionamentos diferentes, mas dialogando sobre esses temas que irão nos ocupar. Confirmando as bases de nossa identidade institucional como Universidade Católica, dirigida e administrada pelo Instituto dos Irmãos Maristas, é sempre oportuno lembrar a exortação apostólica Ex Corde Ecclesiae, que é a carta magna das universidades católicas. No 25º ano da sua publicação, este ano, a citada exortação apostólica diz no parágrafo número 17: a Universidade Católica deve empenhar-se mais especificamente no diálogo entre fé e razão. E continua o citado documento no parágrafo seguinte: os homens da ciência só ajudarão realmente a humanidade se conservarem o sentido da transcendência, transcendência da pessoa sobre o mundo e de Deus sobre o mundo. Este é o posicionamento institucional da PUC, que não exclui nem o diálogo, nem o debate entre posições diferentes. Desejo que este seminário ilumine as mentes e amplie os horizontes, a fim de que seus participantes possam vislumbrar e vir a propagar em seus projetos e em suas realizações a luz verdadeira, a fonte do amor, do saber e da vida. Os meus agradecimentos ao Pró-Reitor de Pesquisa, Inovação e Desenvolvimento, professor Jorge Audi, aqui representado pela professora Carla Bonan. A comissão organizadora, na pessoa da professora Marília Morosini. Aos palestrantes, aos coordenadores e a todos os aqui presentes. Auguro um profícuo seminário para todos. Muito obrigado.
Agradecemos a presença dos componentes da mesa de abertura e convidamos as distintas autoridades a ocuparem seus lugares na primeira fileira deste teatro. De imediato, convidamos a subir ao palco o Dr. Kenneth Miller, da Universidade Brown, para proferir a conferência de abertura intitulada Criacionismo, Evolução e a Compatibilização entre Ciência e Religião. O Dr. Miller é graduado em Biologia pela Universidade de Brown e PhD em Biologia pela Universidade do Colorado. Trabalhou por 6 anos como professor assistente na Universidade de Harvard antes de retornar para a Universidade de Brown no início da década de 80. Seu trabalho de pesquisa sobre estrutura e função da membrana celular já produziu mais de 60 artigos científicos e resenhas publicados em revistas de reconhecimento e projeção mundial. Foi agraciado com 6 grandes prêmios de ensino na Universidade de Brown e, em 2009, homenageado pela Associação Americana para o Avanço da Ciência por promover a compreensão pública da ciência. Entre os prêmios recebidos, destacam-se o prêmio Stephen Jay Gould, da Sociedade para o Estudo da Evolução, recebido em 2011, e em 2014, a medalha Leigh Terry, conferida pela Universidade de Notre Dame. Ao final da palestra, informamos que o padre Érico Rams, professor da Faculdade de Teologia da PUC-RS, coordenará o momento de interação com o nosso palestrante. Desejamos a todos um ótimo seminário. Com a palavra, o Dr. Kenneth Miller.
Bom tarde, good afternoon. It is a pleasure to be here. I apologize for the fact that my talk will be in English, although with the help of a graduate student from my university, I have translated as much of the slides as I can into Portuguese. I'd also request that the person controlling the lights turn down the lights so that the slides would become more visible rather than spotlighting them. Obrigado. I want to thank the university for inviting me, your president and professors. It is an honor and a pleasure to visit the beautiful country of Brazil. This is my first time in Brazil. I hope very much it will not be the last, and I will make a point of trying very hard to come back with my wife next year to watch the Olympics in Rio. And many people in America, in my country, are looking forward to that. I should introduce myself a little bit more. I am a cell biologist. I work on the structure and function of biological membranes. My main research tool is the electron microscope, and my work has been published and featured on the cover of journals like Nature and Cell and the Journal of Cell Biology. But if there's a reason why I might be here today, it might be because of something else I have done, and that is I am the author of textbooks for the secondary level for the high school market that are widely used in the United States and other countries. They have also been translated into Spanish. We are hoping very much for a Portuguese edition, but nothing on the horizon yet. And I will tell you an anecdote, and I think most of you have English, which is good enough so you will understand it. I live in a very small town in the state of Massachusetts. The name of the town is Rehoboth. It's small, but it is one of the oldest communities in the United States. It was founded in 1643, so it's been there a very long time. And for many years, people in our town knew me very well, but it wasn't because I was a professor of biology. It's because for almost 10 years, I coordinated the baseball and softball programs, and I coached sports, so everybody knew Miller as the baseball and softball guy. And then one day, the high school, Dighton Rehoboth High School, adopted one of my books, The Elephant on the Cover, as the textbook. And my name was on the cover, and my picture was inside. And about a month into that school year, you might think it's wonderful to have the school in your own community use a book that you wrote, and I suppose it is. But about a month into that school year, I was driving to high school to pick up my younger daughter, Tracy, after athletic practice. And when I drove in front of the high school, there was a woman I knew from softball. She was another coach. Her name was Bonnie Kelly. And she saw me and she said, Ken, she waved the truck down. And I drove up and I put the window down. And I said, Bonnie, what's up? And she says, Ken, you wrote the book they use in the high school. And I said, yes, I did. And she looked me in the eyes and she said, funny thing is you don't seem that smart. So I was never quite sure what to make of that, but there were other interesting stories as well. I have also written two popular books for general audiences on evolution. One is called Only a Theory. The other one, which has been a bestseller in America, is called Finding Darwin's God. And Finding Darwin's God tells of what I talk about as the search for common ground between God and evolution. And given your theme of science and transcendence, I thought I would point this out. And much of what I will talk about today is in fact described in that book. Now, I think many of you may know that evolution is the source of conflict and argument and debate in American culture. It was 10 years ago that Time magazine, one of the leading magazines in the United States, published a cover story called The Evolution Wars. And the evolution wars in my country still go on, and they go on in many ways. I thought I would show you this sign, which appeared outside a church in the state of Florida, as an example of how evolution is still controversial. More than 40% of Americans reject the theory of evolution in favor of biblical creationism. And the sign that you see here in this church says, if man evolved from monkeys, why are monkeys still here? And I cannot tell you how many times I have been asked that question. question when I give lectures. And I want to tell you how I answer it. So I answer it by, first of all, pointing to the person who asked the question and say, first, I have a question for you. And the question I have for you is, where did Protestants come from? And they're very confused at first. And I said, now, come on, Martin Luther, the Reformation, where did Protestants come from? And they say, oh, they came from Catholics. That's true. So my next question is, are Catholics still here? Claro, of course. And the reason that this answers the question is because we did not evolve from monkeys, but rather we share a common ancestor, not just with monkeys, but with other primates and with all living things, in the same way that all Christians today, Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox Christian, share common ancestors in the early church. And I have always thought that the evolution of religion was a good analogy for the evolution of species. Now, in the USA, one of our largest states is Texas. And in the USA 2 years ago, people on the school board of Texas, of that state, considered banning our textbook because of the treatment of evolution. This is the Texas version of our textbook. It's Biology by Miller and Levine. And this is an article from the leading newspaper in the United States, the New York Times, pointing out that one textbook in particular, and of course that is ours, was considered for banning because of its treatment to evolution. Now, I'm very happy to tell you that that did not happen. This was an enormous controversy. Experts were brought in, and our textbook was in fact approved after a very long argument. And I have to tell you that the publicity surrounding the argument probably helped us, because our book then sold more copies in Texas than in any other state. So we're very, very happy about this. But this argument goes on. And in the United States, we are about a year away from a presidential election. And many of the candidates running for the presidential nomination right now reject the theory of evolution. Mike Huckabee up here is one. Scott Walker, who's one of the leading candidates, rejects the theory of evolution. So this has become a political issue as well. And many of those who reject evolution embrace instead what they call the theory of intelligent design. And intelligent design is essentially an argument that living things are too complex to have been produced by the process of evolution, and therefore there must be an intelligent designer that put things like the cell together, the biochemical pathways of metabolism, and so forth. And advocates of intelligent design present their ideas as genuine science, and they ask that it be taught in American classrooms alongside the theory of evolution. Now, about 10 years ago, one board of education in the United States decided to do that. This is the headline, Intelligent Design Voted In. And the school board of the small town of Dover, Pennsylvania, decided to instruct their teachers to prepare a curriculum on intelligent design. This is a very small town. These are all of the science teachers of Dover High School, all three of them. And at the risk of losing their jobs, they not only refused to teach intelligent design, they even refused to read a statement in the classroom on intelligent design. So what the school board did was to send the superintendent, the dean, into biology classrooms one day to teach a lesson on intelligent design and to distribute intelligent design textbooks. The very next day, 11 parents of students at Dover, objecting to the school board's policy, went to federal court and filed a lawsuit based on the First Amendment to the Constitution against the Dover Board of Education. This is the text of the lawsuit. This is a press conference at which these teachers appeared. This lawsuit is known as Kitzmiller versus Dover, named after this woman right here. Her name is Tammy Kitzmiller. Her daughters were students in the biology classroom. Now, the United States has different relationships between government and religion from many other countries. And I know many of you are familiar with the American Constitution, but for those of you who are not, I would point out that the most important part of our Constitution may be the First Amendment. And that establishes freedom of speech, freedom of the press, and freedom of religion. And in part, it reads, "Congress shall make no law regarding the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof." The First Amendment is understood not just to apply to Congress, but to apply to all government agencies, including school boards, state governments, local governments, and so forth. The basis of the lawsuit was that if intelligent design can be shown to be religious and not scientific, then teaching it in the public schools is prohibited by the United States Constitution. And that was the basis for a trial in federal court in Pennsylvania in 2005. The trial began almost exactly 10 years ago. I was the lead witness in the trial. If you look closely, you will see that I am wearing the same tie I am wearing today. I call this my lucky tie. And I spent 2 days on the witness stand. And the goal of my testimony in the trial was, first of all, to show that intelligent design is not scientific. The arguments that it makes against evolution were wrong. They were in error. And the second goal of my testimony was to show that intelligent design is not a scientific movement, but is a religious movement. Now, there's nothing wrong with a religious movement, but the American Constitution says you cannot use public schools to advance or to hinder religion. And this was the basis of the lawsuit. The trial lasted for 7 weeks. This is actually, cameras, video is not allowed in a courtroom in federal court in the United States. So news media have to make sketches. And this is from a television station sketch of me in the courtroom on the first day being cross-examined. And these are my books on the table, and these are the attorneys for the school board. But the trial demonstrated nothing so much as the complete collapse of intelligent design as anything even resembling a scientific theory. In December 20th, 2005, the judge announced his decision. The judge, incidentally, is a Republican who was appointed to the bench by President George W. Bush, and therefore was a very conservative judge. But the judge announced very simply, intelligent design is not science. This was front page news on newspapers like the New York Times, USA Today. This was on the evening news broadcasts of all three major television networks. And the plaintiffs, who were the parents of students, were very, very happy that this threat to their religious freedom had been stopped by the court. So the court rules, again, intelligent design simply is not science. Now, I was very happy with that verdict, not surprisingly, and I would love to pretend that after this court ruling, we are done with this in the United States. We don't have to argue about this anymore. It has been tested. It has been shown to be wrong. But you know, and I know, that that is not the case. Controversies over evolution continue in the United States, and we continue to argue about this as the current presidential election shows. Now, I would like to pretend that this is a problem in just one country, mine, but it's not. And it turns out this is an issue in Europe as well. Here's an article showing that a majority of people in Great Britain think that evolution should be taught in schools. These are some German anti-evolution books. If you don't speak German, Die Evolutionslüge, which means the evolution lie, is being distributed to German school children and so forth. Evolution, ein kritisches Lehrbuch, a critical lesson book. This is happening in Britain, and I have gone to Germany, to the Netherlands, to Sweden, and to Britain to lecture about anti-evolutionism in Europe. I would hope that a rising scientific power like Brazil would not submit to the same temptation, but you know that is not true, that evolution is controversial in Brazil as well. This is last year. A bill was introduced in the Brazilian Chamber of Deputies that would require the teaching of creationism in schools in Brazil. This bill did not pass, but as you can see, the rationale given by the member of the Chamber of Deputies was to teach only evolution in schools is to violate freedom of belief because most Brazilian religions believe in creationism advocated and taught by the Catholic Church. That is not true, but nonetheless, that is in fact the argument that was made in your Chamber of Deputies. This is a result of a survey that were taken a year or two ago, and it turns out that very few people in Brazil actually accept the scientific view of evolution. According to this poll, one-third, 31%, of Brazilians believe that human beings were directly created by God 10,000 years ago and have not changed since that time. It also turns out, and these are numbers which are larger than in the United States, 89% said creationism should be taught in schools, and 75% said that creation should be taught instead of the theory of evolution. Now, these are surprising numbers. In the United States, one of the big differences is control of education. In my country, is local, which is why an individual school board can do what the school board did in Dover. Control of education in Europe and also in Brazil is more national, so we don't have local arguments about this, but this is a surprising feature. Here's another article I found in the press saying creationism gains acceptance in Brazil. Some of you may know that the former governor of the state of Rio actually tried to introduce the teaching of creationism in schools. And this is an article that appeared within the last year from a Brazilian academic from one of your universities talking about the way that creationism and intelligent design are influencing educational policy in Brazil. And as I say, for a great nation and a rising scientific power, and that Brazil is a rising scientific power, this is worrisome. Now, is evolution true? Well, the answer is, you might expect me to say, because I'm a biologist, of course it is. And we know about evolution from several lines of evidence. We know, for example, about evolution from the fossil evidence. We can trace, for example, the evolution of birds. This fossil here is one of the most famous. It was actually discovered by a colleague of mine named Steve Gatesy at Brown in an expedition led by Neil Shubin from the University of Chicago. This is Tiktaalik. Tiktaalik is a critical link between lobe fin fishes and the very first amphibians that showed how land-based mammals first evolved. The National Academy of Sciences in the United States, which is our most prestigious scientific body, has talked about this, and they said that so many intermediate forms have been discovered that it is often difficult to determine categorically when the transition occurs from one particular species to another. That is how detailed the evolutionary fossil record has become. And this fossil, Tiktaalik, shown right here, fits into a beautiful evolutionary sequence that shows us basically how lobed fin fishes first evolved fins that changed into the limbs of today's vertebrates, including ourselves. So increasingly, the fossils tell us a great deal about evolutionary history. Now, it turns out that the same is true with the fossil record of human beings, of our own species. There is no missing link between us and pre-human species. And in fact, in the last quarter century, we have discovered so many intermediate forms that link us to our pre-human ancestors, that there is no longer any doubt that our species evolved, and that just like every other organism on this planet, we have a history. We were produced by the process of evolution. But I am not a paleontologist. I don't work with fossils. I do work with molecular biology. And it turns out that some of the most spectacular evidence for evolution is not in fossils, but is in the human genome. And I want to show you an issue of the journal Nature that came out about 10 years ago. It highlighted the DNA sequence of the chimpanzee genome. And the authors of the lead article pointed out that more than a century ago, Darwin and Huxley postulated that we share recent common ancestors with the African great apes. And they also noted that studies of molecular biology have spectacularly confirmed this idea. Now, this was true. This magazine came out 2 weeks before the trial in which I testified in Pennsylvania, and I told the people I was working with, I have to find a way to bring this information into the courtroom. The problem was much of the molecular biology was very complicated, and when I explained it to the lawyers we were working with, they shook their heads, and they said, and the biologists in the room may understand these words, if you discuss, Ken, the degree of conservation of syntony, the judge will fall asleep. You have to put this, and I hope you appreciate, I don't really mean this, you have to put this in terms that are so simple that even a lawyer can understand them. So that was the idea. So I found a way to do that. And that is, and here's a particularly interesting thing that you may or may not know. We humans carry in our cells 46 chromosomes. However, all of the other great apes, gorillas, orangutans, chimpanzees, bonobos, they all have 48 chromosomes. So we have 46 and they have 48. Now, those of you trained in biology know that our 46 chromosomes come in two sets of 23. Each of us got 23 chromosomes from our mother and 23 from our father. A baby chimpanzee gets 24 from mother and 24 from father. So we are missing a pair of chromosomes. Now, what could have happened? What could explain this discrepancy? Is it possible that a pair of chromosomes just got destroyed, just got lost? The answer to that is no. There are so many important genes on every primate chromosome that the loss of what biologists call a homologous pair of chromosomes would be fatal. You couldn't even develop as an embryo. So the only possibility that makes any sense is that two chromosomes that are still separate in the other primates got accidentally stuck together to form a single chromosome in us. And that would have changed us from 24 pairs down to 23. So that explains it. However, that's not evidence. Here is why evolution is science and not just a guess. If this is true, then it means that somewhere in the human genome, there must be a chromosome that was recently fused, recently formed by that fusion. So how would we recognize such a chromosome? It turns out to be easier than you might think. What I've done here is to diagram two chromosomes. The tips of every chromosome have a very special region, I've shown it in blue, known as the telomere. There's a repeating DNA sequence in the telomere, which is very easy to recognize. It's only found at the tips. Then there is an equally special region known as the centromere. If one of our chromosomes had been formed by the fusion of two chromosomes, do you know what it should look like? It should have telomere DNA in the middle where it does not belong, and it should have two different centromeres. So that's a very firm prediction. So now we can look at the human genome and say, do we have such a chromosome? Well, the answer is we sure do. It's human chromosome number 2. And human chromosome number 2 has telomere DNA in the center, and it has, in fact, two centromeres, one active and one inactive, and we can map the exact point where the fusion occurs. And if you haven't followed how much we know about the human genome, this may surprise you. The fusion point is between bases 114,455,823 and 114,455,838. We know exactly where they came together. There is no way to explain information like this on the basis of intelligent design or special creation. It's a wonderful test of the hypothesis of common ancestry and a wonderful proof of the reality of evolution. And it turns out this is not the only one. There are many books, including one of mine, that have talked about the conclusive molecular evidence for the natural origins of our species. And these are just a few of the books that my colleagues in the United States and Great Britain have published to point this out. Now, in a way, this is the first part of my talk, is to try to establish the reality of the evolutionary process and the role that evolution played in our own species. Now, the second part of my talk deals with something else, and that is, as you know, many scientists will say that science itself excludes the possibility of God, and the first science they talk about is, in fact, evolution. The gentleman you see here, David Barash, University of Washington, is a very well-known, very famous professor of biology at the University of Washington, which is one of our biggest and best state universities. He published an essay in the New York Times not too long ago, and in the essay he said, every year, about this time with the college year starting, I give my students the talk. It is not, as you might expect, about sex or something else, but it's about evolution and religion and how they get along, or more to the point, how they do not get along. And the point that Professor Barash wanted to make, and you can see it here in English, is that evolution has demolished previously potent pillars of religious faith and undermined belief in an all-powerful and all-benevolent God. So that's what Professor Barash is telling his college students in biology class. In biology, he's making a theological point, which is that if human beings were produced by a purely biological process, then there is no room for God. Now, the interesting thing about that is I know Professor Barash understands biology very well. What he does not understand very well is theology. And if I was to talk with him, I would point out the writings of St. Augustine at the beginning of the 5th century. And when you read Augustine, you realize the concept of self-transformation is actually part of the Christian tradition. And this is from the writings of Augustine, who was sophisticated enough to realize that the universe was brought into being in a less than fully formed state. But the universe is gifted to transform itself from unformed matter into a truly marvelous array of structures and life forms. I am convinced that if Augustine were alive today, he would be an evolutionist, because the sentiment that matter can transform itself into life is exactly what we talk about when we talk about evolution. And as a biologist, I would say, even though I have argued against intelligent design, that an evolutionary design to life is part of the inherent fabric of the natural world. Living things do look as though they were designed, but they were designed by the process of evolution. So here's the lesson. There is a capacity for evolutionary change that is built into nature, and this allows believers, people of faith, to understand it as part of God's providential plan. It is possible to understand evolution as the tool of the Creator. One person who has argued this is Simon Conway Morris, a very, very famous paleontologist at the University of Cambridge in England. Conway Morris became famous by reinterpreting fossils of the Cambrian era. He is also a Christian, and wrote a book called Life's Solution, talking about the way in which, in his view, evolution leads inevitably to the production of organisms like human beings. Now, many people ask me, when they know I am a Christian, where is the room for God in the evolutionary process? Where does God stick his finger to ensure that things come out in a certain way? And my answer is, he doesn't. We have no need to find room for God in the evolutionary process, because the process is part of the natural world of his own making. And by definition, evolution as part of that world is going to fulfill the promise of the Creator. But nonetheless, it is difficult sometimes for people of faith to reconcile themselves to ideas like evolution and also the Big Bang, the beginning of the universe. And I am often asked, how can you as a Christian read the book of Genesis and come to grips with what physicists tell us is a Big Bang? And my answer to that actually is a question, which is, if you have trouble as a Christian understanding the Big Bang, I have a question for you. Who was it who actually developed the mathematical foundations of the Big Bang? And when I ask that, the most common guess is Einstein, but that's not true. The person who did the mathematics of the Big Bang is this person right here, whom you can see in a clerical garb. Who is that? Well, the answer is, it is Georges Lemaître. He was a Belgian priest and physicist and mathematician, and he was one of the very few people who understood Einstein's theory of relativity maybe better than Einstein, and explained to Einstein that the theory of relativity requires an expanding universe. And if the universe is expanding, it means it will be bigger tomorrow than it is today. But it also means that yesterday it was smaller than it is today. And last month it was smaller still. And Lemaître realized, if we keep going back, we get to a cosmic singularity, which is what he referred to as a Big Bang. So the person who did this was Georges Lemaître, a physicist and a Catholic priest. Now, Lemaître was often asked, how can you be a priest when you have done work that proves the Big Bang? Doesn't the Big Bang contradict the Bible? But he realized that the Bible is not a book of science, and therefore it does not contradict modern science. And this is from Lemaître himself. And he said, the writers of the Bible were illuminated more or less, some more than others, on the question of salvation. On other questions, they were just as wise or just as ignorant of others as others of their generation. Therefore, it is unimportant if errors of scientific or historical fact appear in the Bible, especially if they refer to events that were not directly observed by those writing the Bible. And of course, the book of Genesis had no direct observers present at the creation of the universe. Now, how about Charles Darwin? Darwin himself recognized that it was possible, although Darwin was not religious, to be a Christian and an evolutionist. In 1879, he wrote back to a correspondent named John Fordyce, and he said, sir, it seems to me absurd to doubt that a man may be an ardent evolutionist and also a theist. Darwin himself realized that Christianity was compatible with evolution, and in his letter, he named Asa Gray, and he called him the eminent botanist. Now, you may not know the name Asa Gray in Brazil, but Asa Gray was a professor at Harvard, was the founder of the botanical sciences in the United States. He was really America's first great botanist, and his scientific stature is so great that he appeared on an American stamp as one of the pioneers of science in my country. Asa Gray was the first vocal supporter of the theory of evolution in the United States. He was also a deacon in the Presbyterian Church and an ardent theist. So Darwin, although not a believer, recognized that one could be a believer and an evolutionist. One of the things that I find ironic is that there are two extremes, creationism and scientific materialism, which rejects God, and they both agree that God must have acted directly to create living things. But what they ignore is a crucial observation, and many of you may know the name Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, which is that God does not so much make the world as to allow the world of life to make itself. Teilhard de Chardin was a Jesuit who also worked in paleontology and wrote enthusiastically about the process of evolution as being the fulfillment of Christian doctrine. Now, this was talked about a few years ago at a wonderful event called the World Science Festival, which now happens every year in the summer in New York City. And if any of you are able to visit New York in the summer, there are many wonderful things to see in the city of New York. See if you can get a ticket to one of the events at the World Science Festival. It's remarkable. I was lucky enough to be invited to be a panelist in a discussion of science and faith in 2001. And here's a photograph of part of the discussion. This is a philosopher. Over here is a physicist. You know I'm a biologist. But there's one person right here who's wearing a Roman collar. And you might say, who is this guy? Well, it turns out he is a Vatican astronomer who was present in the panel. His name is Guy Consolmagno. He is a Jesuit. Despite the elegant Italian name, Guy Consolmagno is an American with a PhD in physics from MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, probably our best technical university. And he's written wonderful books about physics and religion. And here's something that Guy once said that I really stand by very much. He said, "My belief in God is not because of something I've seen in science. I turn it the other way around and I say, I believe in science because of my faith in God." Now, that's not the way people usually look at it. But his point is that faith validates science. And the way that Brother Guy explains this is basically by saying, it's not the case that I will use science to prove a religious point. I do think they interact. Religion is what motivates me to do science. And then he says, religion is what gives me the courage to say there are going to be answers. The universe is rational. And he argues that science is finding that we can investigate the rational universe makes perfect sense if we believe ultimately there is a rational intelligence behind the universe in a transcendent form. The reality is that we consider to be rational science is actually inspired by religious faith and conviction. Albert Einstein did not believe in God. But Albert Einstein once said, while it is true that scientific results are entirely free from independent religious and moral considerations, those individuals to whom we owe the great creative acts of science were all imbued with a religious conviction that the universe of ours is something perfect and susceptible to the rational striving for knowledge. I like to say that all scientists share two elements of faith. First element is the universe is understandable. And the second element is that knowledge is better than ignorance, that it is better to understand the universe than to be baffled by it. Now, what kind of God could exist in a scientific world in which things happen according to predictable rules, which can be studied, described, and understood? And that is the world in which we live. And my answer is a God who fashioned a world that is rational and intelligent. To people of faith, therefore, God is not the antithesis of science. Rather, he is the reason why science works in the first place. And I think that's an insight that many of my non-religious scientific friends simply don't appreciate. Life is material, and the capacity for life is built into the physics of chemistry and matter. Evolution, therefore, is an inherent and predictable part of nature. And therefore, if the ultimate cause of the natural world is the will of God, then therefore evolution itself reflects the will of the Creator. Now, do other scientists believe in that? This is Theodosius Dobzhansky, probably the greatest evolutionary geneticist of the 20th century. He wrote an article many years ago called, and I'll say it in English, "Nothing in Biology Makes Sense Except in the Light of Evolution." And the title is the message of the article. But in the article, he wrote something interesting. The diversity of life is understandable if the Creator created the living world not by caprice, I would say not by intelligent design, but by evolution propelled by natural selection. Then he wrote, "It is wrong to hold creation and evolution as mutually exclusive alternatives. I, Dobzhansky, am a creationist and an evolutionist." Dobzhansky was a Christian. He said, "Evolution is God's or nature's method of creation. Creation is not an event that happened in 4004 BC. It is a process that began some 10 billion years ago and is still underway today." So that's a scientist. How about someone who is religious, someone in the church? Well, here is Pope Benedict. And while he was pope, a group of Italian journalists asked him if evolution was compatible with creationism. And he said, "Of course evolution is compatible. The contrast between evolution and creation is an absurdity because there are many scientific tests in favor of evolution, which appears as a reality that we must see and enriches our understanding of life and being." Now, that's a very complicated way of saying it. So I always joke with people in the United States that when I find something is too complex to understand, I go to a popular newspaper called the New York Post, and the New York Post clears it up for me. Evolution and God do mix, Pope. Or, if you will, in Portuguese, there it is, Pope, they mix. How about Pope Francis? And this, to me, is one of the most interesting developments in the church in my lifetime, is the election of Pope Francis. Well, first of all, he is a Jesuit. He was originally trained as a chemist, so he has scientific training. Jesuits have been outspoken in their support of science. You saw that with Guy Consolmagno, who's one of the Jesuit astronomers at the Vatican. And they have included support in evolution. And I have found in the United States, when I was looking for a priest who would back up my words about evolution, inevitably it was a Jesuit scientist who would endorse what I was saying. And in fact, as you know, Pope Francis last year said, "Look, evolution and the Big Bang are real." And I think that's a very powerful statement. Now, the interesting thing about that is in the United States, many people thought that was revolutionary. And I was actually called up by both Time magazine, that's the big magazine I showed you before, and an equally big magazine called Newsweek, asking if I would like to comment on this remarkable statement by the Pope. And I'm afraid I never got into print because what I told them was this was the least surprising news story of 2014. No one who understood the support of the church for science would have been surprised by that. And the reason for that, again, this was picked up by a United Kingdom paper. The comments of Pope Francis on the Big Bang and evolution are not revolutionary. They are part of exactly the same tradition that produced Georges Lemaître. So that's an important thing to understand. Now, what I'd like to do at this point is to sum up. And I would put it in a number of ways, my summation. First of all, I think that faith suffers to the extent that it rejects the gifts of understanding provided by science. And I found it very painful in my country to see fellow Christians saying, "We cannot trust science, we cannot believe science," because they are turning themselves away from the gift of understanding. I think that science stuff suffers by means of the very deep hostility that many scientists show to faith. And I think that is sad as well, because as I often try to explain to my scientific colleagues, modern science began in Christian Western Europe as part of the Christian tradition of trying to appreciate God by the study of the natural world. And the habits and the names and the characteristics of modern science are very much in the religious tradition of the Christian West. And in fact, science and faith, I would argue, both come from the same basic human need, which is the desire to understand. Now, if I had to give one summary slide of how I regard evolution, and I've often been asked by people, don't I regard evolution as demeaning or demoralizing or degrading? Isn't it terrible to think that you're descended from monkeys or that your ancestors crawled out of the slime in some sort of ancient earth? I cannot come up with words any better to answer that question than the words that were written by the person who kept this notebook. Now, I don't know how many of you have seen this page in this notebook before. I was able, about 3 years ago, to touch this notebook with my own hands. I had to wear gloves, of course. And it sent shivers down my spine. And you can see up here on this notebook, the person who kept it wrote, "I think," and then made a diagram of the sort that no one had made before, tried to explain it here, and then a few weeks later, the notebook, by the way, was written in 1837, came back and wrote a few more explanatory notes in the margin here. And it is very rare in the history of science that you can look on one page of paper and say, right there is one of the greatest discoveries on that page in the history of science, but there it is. Now, the person who kept that notebook in 1859 published a book, and it's a book that you have all heard of. The final sentence of that book has sentiments about the theory of evolution that I cannot even hope to duplicate. And in the last sentence, here's what that person wrote. He wrote, "There is grandeur in this view of life, with its several powers having been originally breathed into a few forms or into one, and that while this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed laws of gravity, from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most wonderful and most beautiful, have been and are being evolved." That's the final sentence of The Origin of Species by Charles Darwin. And ladies and gentlemen, those, I would submit, are words of transcendence, words to live by. Muito obrigado. You have the headset for the translation.
Professor Ken, muito obrigado da nossa parte por essa sua exposição e por nos introduzir de uma forma tão carinhosa, tão querida e tão simpática nesse tema da ciência, da inovação, da universidade e da transcendência. Eu estou particularmente feliz por esse momento, porque na universidade nós trabalhamos esse tema de diferentes maneiras, com diferentes iniciativas, vários projetos procuram estabelecer esse diálogo, fé e cultura, por exemplo, teologia e ciências, reflexões e em atividades que nós oferecemos aos estudantes, também conversas e debates abertos sobre criação e evolução, de maneira que nós ficamos muito agradecidos por esse seu testemunho, que não é apenas uma fala, não é apenas uma ideia, mas é uma existência em defesa daquilo que é a liberdade de pensamento, a seriedade de pesquisa e a abertura à transcendência, que inclui e exige efetivamente que todas as pessoas possam pesquisar, conhecer e conhecer sempre melhor a realidade e o mundo em que vivemos e no cosmos no qual nós nos movemos. Nós podemos agora, então, passar para perguntas. Deve ter microfone à disposição. Há uma primeira pergunta. Quem quiser escrever a pergunta no bloco e mandar por escrito, pode mandar, e nós vamos, então, fazer chegar ao professor Ken. Nitamar está com a palavra, eu acho. Isso.
Posso em português? Ou...
Pode ser em português, sim.
Okay. Bom, muitíssimo obrigado pela belíssima conferência. Realmente, eu já assisti muitas palestras e discussões sobre esse tema de criacionismo e evolução, tanto aqui no Brasil quanto nos Estados Unidos, mas confesso que essa sua palestra foi a mais brilhante e mais interessante de todas que eu já ouvi pessoalmente. Uma pergunta por curiosidade, professor Miller. Como é que o senhor vê essa situação, por exemplo, nos Estados Unidos, de colegas seus que sejam biólogos, estão muitos até com que são da área da biologia com PhD em biologia, e que, no entanto, sejam anti-evolucionistas? Porque eu fiquei realmente muito chocado com os números da nossa situação brasileira. Não é? É realmente chocante. E, no caso brasileiro, podemos pensar, em grande parte, a falta de maior acesso a uma educação de qualidade, muita ignorância, pouco acesso a uma verdadeira educação científica em nível de ensino fundamental, ensino médio, nas nossas escolas, favorecem a essa propagação de ideias criacionistas. Mas no modelo, na situação americana, como o senhor tenta explicar que colegas que possam ter um PhD em biologia e, no entanto, sejam anti-evolucionistas? Obrigado.
Oh, that's right. I'm wearing a microphone. That's a very good question. The first thing I would tell you is that perhaps education in the United States is not as sophisticated as you think it is. I would say that one of the core elements of the American character is disrespect for authority. And that includes educational and scientific authority. I like to remind my Canadian friends that they very humbly asked England for their independence for 200 years, and finally they got it. In America, we picked up rifles and cannons, and we took our independence from Britain because of disrespect for the crown. And there's an old American saying, which is, if you're so smart, why aren't you rich? And that I think, fits to the American character. So it's important to understand also that the United States, like Brazil, is a very religious country. And many Americans go to church on Sunday, and they are told, you will go to hell if you believe in evolution. And that is a very powerful statement. So that's one reason. As to why someone with a PhD can endorse creationism. I am always baffled by that. I do not doubt their sincerity. But the fact of the matter is, and anyone at a university knows this, is having a PhD does not mean that you are wise. And that's a very important thing to understand. There's an acronym for PhD in English, and people will joke about it and say that PhD means piled higher and deeper. And what they mean, piled higher and deeper, is not something that I want to mention in public at this point. But the other thing I would emphasize is that the actual numbers of people who hold PhDs and take this position is extremely small. We are talking about less than 0.1% of members of scientific societies in the United States. One of the most prominent intelligent design advocates is a professor of biochemistry at Lehigh University in Pennsylvania, very good university. His name is Michael Behe. Behe testified in the same trial that I did. When Behe wrote a book on intelligent design, his entire department at Lehigh University put up a web page on the web dissociating themselves from his ideas. So here is one biologist among more than 100 embracing these ideas. So I never doubt the lure of a powerful idea, religion is a powerful idea, to cause people to basically abandon scientific reason, and I think that's what's going on. The other problem is that I think much of this is part of what we call the culture wars in the United States. And by that I mean that evolution is often associated with a culture of materialism that is anti-religious, that says that faith is of no value, and that religious institutions are the worst things that have ever appeared. So in many ways there is a reaction against the culture war. And many people say, well, evolution is at the cutting edge of the culture war, therefore we must cut evolution off. So I don't know if I've completely answered your question, but that is my response. And thank you for a very good question.
Aqui, irmão Joaquim, por gentileza. Aqui na porta, desculpa.
Professor, o senhor nos falou sobre evolução. Evolução da vida. Na sua opinião, quais seriam as primeiras partículas de vida no universo?
Boy, that's why don't you ask me a difficult question? I would put it this way, and that is, life is a phenomenon of chemistry and physics. And this means that the potential for life, whether you are a believer in God or not, the potential for life is built into the matter and energy of our universe. From what we know about the history of our own planet, the Earth is about 4.5 billion years old, and living things appeared on this planet within about 500 million years. So if the first 10% of the history of this planet was all that was required for the first living cells to appear. And what that suggests to me is that self-replicating or self-copying chemical reactions will happen quite commonly under the right conditions. There is a very famous equation known as the Drake equation, which is used to compute, but I should say to guess, at the probability of finding life elsewhere in the universe. There are, I think, 7 terms in the Drake equation. We now know probably pretty well about 3 of those terms, and one of them in particular, which is the number of Earth-like planets in our own section of the universe. We used to think that there were no Earth-like planets except for ours. We now know that there may be as many as 100 just in our area of the Milky Way. And since there are 100 billion stars in the Milky Way, and there are hundreds of billions of other galaxies, it's incomprehensible to me that life does not exist elsewhere. So I think you have life as soon as you have chemical reactions which become self-propagating and therefore subject to natural selection. I believe that capacity is built into matter. The evidence shows it happened very quickly on the early Earth. I think that capacity exists at many places in the universe, and I don't know if we will ever find life elsewhere during our lives, but I have every reason to expect that sooner or later we will encounter living things elsewhere in the universe. I hope that answers your question.
Eu tenho uma duas perguntas aqui por escrito, se não houver alguém. Isso, lá no fundo. Eu já vou preparar essa aqui. Aqui também tem uma. Ótimo. Palmini, sim.
Obrigado. I'll ask the question in English. Is that okay? So thanks for a very good talk. I'm an evolutionary biology professor here at this university, so I go through the same discussions and use some of the similar examples. And Father Erico and myself have been involved in many debates exactly on this topic, so it's very much a pleasure to see you talking in person to us about this. So one of the sayings or the quotes by Dobzhansky that I think is quite interesting is when he said he, as a religious person, thought it was blasphemy to state that there was no evolution, because you would then imply that God was lying to people and was creating all these false leads upon which all the scientists pretty much in the world now think there is evolution. So if they're all false leads, then that's blasphemy, because you're thinking God would deceive people like this. So I'd like you to comment on this and ask you if you have used this before talking to religious people and how they respond to that.
That's a very good point. And in my book, Finding Darwin's God, I have one chapter that is called God the Charlatan, which means God the Deceiver. And it deals with the argument that surely God could not have lied to us by putting so much evidence for evolution present. The other approach that I take is when I confront the argument from intelligent design, which is that living things are so complex that they appear to have been designed, so there must be an intelligent designer. My response to that is the one thing that we know, if there was a designer, the one thing we know about this designer is that he is incompetent, because 99.99% of every living thing he has designed has become extinct. So how does that make him a good designer? So, and that's very much aligned with your answer. So I think your answer is very good, and I've used it myself.
Palmini está com o microfone, pode falar.
Muito obrigado pela sua excelente colocação.
Thank you.
Vi que na sua apresentação um dos seus prêmios foi o prêmio Stephen Jay Gould, que é uma pessoa que é um evolucionista e um biólogo que eu tive a oportunidade de ouvi-lo. E eu gostei tanto da palestra, muito parecida com a sua, assim, na verve, não é? Que eu comprei um livro dele, chama-se Rock of Ages, até dividi com alguns amigos meus aqui, e que justamente ele propala, né, propõe uma situação do que ele chama de non-overlapping magisteria, né? Como se ciência e religião fossem duas vias independentes que deveriam e poderiam se auxiliar, não é, no entendimento da vida. Já que eu sou numa universidade que é uma universidade católica e que tem também a função de propagar o conhecimento e lidar com o conhecimento, nós somos pessoas aqui que temos essa obrigação. Que conselho o senhor daria para nós, assim, para lidar com esse assunto, nessa diversidade cultural do mundo que a gente vive hoje em dia?
André, thank you very much for that question. I have to tell you, Stephen Jay Gould was a friend of mine. I was assistant professor at Harvard from 1974 through 1980, and Stephen Jay Gould and I served on a curriculum committee together. And at the time, I did not know who he was, and what I mean by that, I thought Steve was a person whose lab was in the museum. He studied snails. That was his research area. And the only thing that I knew about Steve besides the snails was that he liked baseball as much as I did. And it was only when I left Harvard and went to Brown that I realized that Stephen Jay Gould had written all these marvelous books. So I have to tell you a story that relates to that, because you mentioned Gould's book, which is called Rocks of Ages in English, and Non-Overlapping Magisteria. If you read the essays that Gould wrote every month for years and years, prior to 1981 or 1982, many of these essays are very stridently anti-religious. In 1982, I hosted Steve to give a seminar at my university. So he came to visit me. I have a photograph of myself and Steve in the office together. And we started to talk. And he opened his briefcase and he pulled out the most beautiful envelope I have ever seen. It was parchment paper. It had a yellow and white ribbon and a wax seal on it. And it was an invitation to Steve from the Pontifical Academy of Sciences to come to Rome and participate in a conference on evolution. And Steve said, "Ken, you're a Catholic, aren't you?" I said, "Yes." And he says, "What do you know about the Pontifical Academy of Sciences?" And I said, "Well, I don't know too much, but I think the church thinks that it messed up the whole Galileo thing. They don't want to do that again. So this is a group that advises the Pope and the Holy See on matters of science." And then Steve said, "Does the Pope know I'm a Jewish kid from New York City?" And I said, "The Pope knows everything." So, but he went to the conference. And I think that was the first time in his life that he ever was among people whom he considered his intellectual and scientific equals who were also people of faith. And that made a big impression on him, because many scientists believe that religious people are stupid. And he quickly discovered that was not always true. You can trace a change in Gould's writing to when he came back from that conference. And all of a sudden, there's much more respect for religion. He comes up with this idea of non-overlapping magisteria, religion over here, science over here. As long as they accept the boundaries, everything can get along fine. And that was the theme of his book. Now, he made many very good points in that book. But I do think that that solution of non-overlapping is not quite right, because I think science and faith do interact in many ways. And you heard what Guy Consolmagno has written, that his faith gives him faith in science, that says there will be an answer, the universe will be rational. So, religious people should never tell scientists what they have to discover. And scientific people should never pretend to say, "I have looked for God scientifically and have not found him, therefore he does not exist." So Gould makes many valuable points, but I think science and faith do interact in many ways, and those of you who teach courses on science and religion spot those areas of interaction. Stephen Jay Gould, as many of you may know, died in 2002. He was 60 years old. I never thought, as a young man, I never thought that I would ever say that someone who died at 60 died much too young, but he did die much too young. And when the Society for the Study of Evolution gave me the Stephen Jay Gould Award, I was beside myself. It was a great honor. He was a brilliant writer on evolutionary theory, and although he was an agnostic, he did not believe in God, he had enormous respect for religion and people of faith. And I wish more scientists felt the same way.
Existe uma pergunta que veio por escrito que vai... uma pergunta por escrito que vai exatamente nessa questão da relação fé e ciência. Como é que se dá, se pode explicitar essa relação?
I think you mean how can I explain the relation between faith and science? Well, science is the study of the natural world. In science, we deal only with material things, with matter and energy. We make hypotheses about how things work, and we try to test these hypotheses. And what that means, basically, is there is a whole world, a whole universe that science can investigate, how our bodies work, what the nature of matter is, where the universe originated, and so forth. But there are other questions that science is not competent to investigate. They include the questions, the classic questions of Greek philosophy. What is the good life? What is right and wrong? What is the purpose of life? Science can tell us about living things, but cannot answer those questions. And the interesting thing about science is that science itself cannot prove that science can answer all questions. And that's a very important thing, that's a very important point to make. Richard Dawkins, who I hold right up there with Gould as a brilliant writer on evolutionary theory, once wrote something like, I'll try to quote it exactly, the universe we know about for science has no evil, no good, no plan, no purpose, nothing but blind, pitiless indifference. Now, when I read that statement, Dawkins is speaking as a scientist, and he says the universe, science tells us the universe has no purpose. It occurred to me when I read that, let us suppose that I went to the scientific meetings, which I will in December, of the American Society for Cell Biology. And I got up and I will give a 15-minute talk there. And suppose I began the talk by saying, through experiments in my laboratory, I have discovered the purpose of life. People would start to laugh. They would call people in from the hallway and they'd say, look, he's going crazy. Science can't tell us about the purpose of life. But interestingly, Richard Dawkins thinks that science can tell us the universe has no purpose. And in fact, I would regard the question of purpose as entirely outside the realm of science. I don't think science can answer it. But that does not mean it's not a question worth answering. So that's one of the ways in which I would make that demarcation.
Alguma outra questão? Sim, isto, por gentileza.
Boa tarde, professor Miller. Eu sou o Lucas, seminarista, primeiro ano de teologia aqui da PUC. E a minha dúvida seria um pouco na questão da cadeia evolutiva. Se existe algum fato histórico ou científico dentro da cadeia evolutiva, na nossa espécie, quando o ser humano foi capaz de transcender, de olhar para o céu e dizer Deus, assim, esse saque, né? Assim, se existe algo científico, algo constatável na história, isso que o senhor possa responder. Obrigado.
No, I cannot answer it. There's something remarkable in the evolution of our species. And I want you to imagine a chart. And on this chart, I have mapped the brain size, the cranial capacity of every hominid species from Australopithecus 4 million years ago to Homo sapiens today. Now, the brain size of Australopithecus was about 400 cubic centimeters, about 400 milliliters, the same size as a chimpanzee today. The human brain size, about 1,400 cubic centimeters. And in the space of 1 million years, the brain size goes like this. Imagine a single organ tripling in size in just 1 million years of evolution. If that happened to the liver, if it happened to the kidney, if it happened to the heart, you would say that organ must be doing something very important for the survival of the species. Well, it didn't happen to the kidney or the liver or the heart, but it did happen to the brain. And I'm not a neuroscientist. We have some neuroscientists here. But one of the things that certainly distinguishes human beings from virtually all other animals is self-consciousness, that we are aware of ourselves and that we're capable of asking these questions. I live on a farm. My wife and I have, over the years, trained horses and dogs to do certain things. I love these animals. I sometimes think they form a special bond. But I never discuss questions of existence with them. And there is something very different about the human animal. We can see the beginnings of that in other primates. One of my former students, a wonderful student named Lucy Spellman, became a zoologist and for 10 years was the director of the National Zoo in Washington, D.C. And I was in Washington one day and Lucy invited me to come. She was the director to see the zoo after it had closed. So 5 o'clock, they closed the zoo. Lucy brought me in and they had just built a new house, a new enclosure for the orangutans. And it was a beautiful habitat with a lot of trees, places for them to hide and live. And there was a glass wall, it was a long room, down the center so that visitors could come in and look through the glass wall and look at the habitat. And Lucy said, go sit down. So there's the glass wall. I pulled up a chair and I sat here. On the other side of the glass wall, one of the orangutans picked up a chair, walked to the other side, sat down, looked me straight in the eyes, and did this. I didn't have a conversation with the orangutan, but I think you can see the beginnings of awareness and consciousness. So the only thing I can tell you is that the biological history of our species shows this enormous increase in the size of the brain. We do not know what caused it. We are beginning to learn the genetic changes that make the nervous system grow faster in a human baby as opposed to a baby of the great apes. And when we understand them completely, which may be in a few years, this may give us some insight as to why our brain is self-conscious, self-aware, why we can develop language, why we have become, of all the primates, we are the most social. We form the largest social groups. And I think all of these things are key. And I think that the religious impulse comes out of that same self-consciousness and the need for explanations. So again, you ask a good question. Remember that I began my answer by saying, no, I can't, and just gave you some speculation. Thank you for asking. Very good question.
Nós temos uma outra pergunta que chegou por escrito. A pergunta é a respeito de evolução de espíritos. O senhor conhece alguma teoria reencarnacionista e assim por diante? Então, se a teoria da evolução pode ser pensada para espíritos?
A very simple answer, no. Science deals with only that we can examine, only matter and energy. And the spiritual world is, I think, by definition, beyond the ability of science to approach. I've given a couple of lectures on neuroscience and the soul, the question of the soul. And one of the things that I always try to emphasize is if the soul exists, if the concept of the soul is real, it is beyond our power to investigate as scientists. But there are many things, I think, that are beyond our power to investigate as science. I think truth and beauty and aesthetics and beauty and art and music are beyond the ability of science to investigate, but that does not make them less real.
Okay. Other question more? Yes. Gentiles.
Eu peço licença para falar de pé, porque eu sempre falei de pé como advogado, que sim, sou advogado.
Você tem que desligar, tem que tirar o fone de ouvido. Tirar o fone do ouvido e ser objetivo como um advogado no pleito final antes de enviar para o júri.
Bom, o primeiro júri que eu fiz foi de 5 jurados. Isso. Mas essa instituição já foi extinta. Então não precisamos pensar muito em júri, só no atual. O antigo já se foi. Mas é o seguinte, o que eu ia perguntar mesmo, estou meio desmemoriado, mas vocês me perdoam, né? 90 anos estão aqui comigo. 50 anos de...
Congratulations, that's wonderful. Yeah.
Então eu queria dizer o seguinte: eu hoje sou advogado aposentado e sou prospector de negócios. Para chegar a negócios, eu tive que entender o que, que é uma comunicação. Como é que a gente comunica, como é que a gente dá uma notícia, assim como se fosse para fazer uma reportagem. Tem lá uma equipe, manda o repórter, o que, que aconteceu, vem e diz, vão de novo lá para conferir se está verdade ou não, para depois botar na mídia. Bom, esse é um exemplozinho, né, que eu estou dizendo. Para receber a notícia. Quando eu recebi a notícia, o chefe da equipe vai dizer, vale, vamos botar na mídia, porque isso aí vai dar repercussão. Então, o que, que acontece? Dentro desse processo, se faz o seguinte, vamos publicar, e aquele que lê vai dizer, é verdade, eu vi isso também, não, é mentira, e não sei o que mais, começam as críticas. Né? Mas se é uma coisa boa, a gente aceita, diz, opa, isso eu aceito. A mesma coisa poderia ser o processo na parte espiritual, porque eu fiz uma pergunta, assim, ali, eu não sabia como é que funcionava isso aqui, eu não ouvi bem, mas ocorre que a pergunta que eu fiz, eu disse assim, a relação entre a fé e a ciência. Eu tive a explicação muito boa a respeito da ciência. Agora, a fé, eu dei a definição. Eu disse que a fé é o firme fundamento das coisas que se esperam e a prova daquilo que não se enxerga. Pô, então, é só fé. Mas acontece que a fé é racional. A fé não é cega, a fé é racional, porque se eu tenho razão, eu vou ler a Bíblia e vejo que é racional. O mundo foi feito em 6 dias, porque é racional. Então, eu fico nessa. E fico também em muitas dúvidas daquilo que a gente sabe hoje e que não sabe. Nós hoje aprendemos dos antigos. Nós não estamos aprendendo de 100 anos a essa parte com a tecnologia, porque já havia isso, já havia, nós temos que descobrir, nós não podemos inventar, nós não podemos fazer ficção, nós não podemos imaginar, não é assim, temos que descobrir, e coisas para descobrir são muitíssimas, mas muitíssimas mesmo. Então, dentro da ciência, claro, a ciência tem liberdade para fazer tudo o que quiser, e faz, mas de repente fica nas hipóteses, isso não dá, isso não é possível, isso não é... Bom, vamos para outro campo, o campo espiritual. Bom, lá você não vai entender, a não ser que sejamos iguais àqueles que quando, na plenitude dos tempos, que já tinha a lei do como é que é, o Hammurabi, a lei do...
Código.
É?
Código de Hammurabi.
Código de Hammurabi, no artigo, não sei quanto lá, que ele escreveu 200 e tantas leis, escreveu num artigo a lei do... É.
Doutor Casarim, por gentileza. É.
Então, termino assim? É. Tá bom, eu agradeço.
Obrigado. Paulo. Eu disse aí.
Well, I thank you for your comments. I congratulate you especially on being 90. My mother will be 90 in 2 years. Perhaps I can introduce you. You raised many interesting points. The Bible says that faith is hope in things unseen. And as a scientist, I would say in science we cannot deal with things that we cannot see. We cannot analyze instrumentally and so forth. But that does not mean those things are not real. It does not mean these questions are not valid. And the ultimate way in which I look at it is this, and that is when I think about existence, when I look up, as one person said, at the stars at night, I ask, you know, what is behind this? What's going on? There's a famous philosophical question. Why is there something rather than nothing? And that question has been asked certainly since Aristotle It is still a valid question today. And the other question, which I think is very profound, was pointed out by Albert Einstein. And again, I love to quote Einstein because he captures things so well. And Einstein said, the most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it is comprehensible. Why should we be able to understand it? And that's a profound question as well. And there are many critics of faith who say that faith is just belief without evidence. But as you point out very well, faith is bounded on evidence. When I was a young man, I did not have a Catholic education. I went to public schools, secular universities. I did have to go to catechism and so forth. But one of the things I did this over summer, is I read Summa Theologica by Aquinas. And I was struck by Thomas Aquinas' emphasis that faith and reason are both gifts from God. And therefore, we have faith in reason, and we must apply reason to faith. And that, to get back to your question, Andre, is one of the reasons why I think Gould's idea of non-overlapping is too simplistic, which is reason itself, scientific reason, requires a kind of faith, and faith must be subject to rationality. And I think those are the points that you raised in your comments. I concur with them, and I thank you for them. Thanks.
Thank you. Nós temos mais alguma pergunta? Do contrário, nós... Lá no fundo, sim, por gentileza. Então, essa é a última pergunta.
Boa tarde, professor. Boa tarde, professor. Eu sou seminarista, sou do terceiro ano de teologia, e gostaria de fazer uma pergunta. O senhor falava que a ciência não tem o dever de apresentar um propósito da vida, né? O teólogo Teilhard de Chardin...
What I said was that science cannot tell us the purpose of life.
Ciência não pode dizer.
Então, o teólogo Teilhard de Chardin, ele escreve sobre o sentido da evolução, apresentando o homem como a flecha e o eixo central da evolução. Então, ele vê um sentido na evolução, ou seja, converge para o ponto ômega. Eu gostaria que talvez o senhor pudesse desenvolver um pouquinho sobre esse tema, se possível.
Yes, I'd be glad to. Teilhard de Chardin saw evolution as leading to God. And he, in particular, talked about approaching an omega point. Omega, of course, being the last letter of the alphabet. You start with alpha, you end with omega. And he said, evolution is leading us to perfection. It's a very interesting idea. And I love the way that Teilhard de Chardin approached science as an aid to faith, that science deepened our faith, and it certainly deepened his. As a biologist, however, I would say that that idea requires that evolution is moving towards an end point, and at a certain point will stop. There is nothing in our current understanding of the evolutionary process that says that evolution is ever finished. Is our species continuing to evolve? Well, you only need two things for evolution to take place. One is variation within a species. So look around the room, look at the different colors, heights, and so forth. Do we have variation? Yes. The next thing that you need is differential reproductive success. Some of you of adult age have no children. Some of you have one. I have two. I have a good friend who has seven. That is differential reproductive success. And as long as a species has variation and differential reproduction, you have evolution. So I think evolution will go on. I think that almost all biologists would regard Deschardin's ideas of an omega point as being interesting theologically, but naive biologically. So those are my comments.
Muito bem, muito obrigado de novo, Ken, por esta sua presença entre nós. Nós lhe desejamos ainda boas horas em Porto Alegre, com chuva e com frio, se for o caso, mas uma boa viagem amanhã de volta. E estamos aqui à espera de sua próxima vinda. E, em todos os casos, se puder vir ao Rio de Janeiro no próximo ano, que seja uma boa experiência. E, em casa, lhe desejamos igualmente tudo de bom. Muito obrigado. Sim. E agradecemos a todos.
Thank you so much. Thank you.